Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for the introduction. I'm going to introduce you this topic, equitable, reasonable, and sustainable use of water resources in Cambodia from a legal point of view. Because this research project has also its origin in the Dockside project, and the people originally involved in this project, we had a legal background. So we decided to address this topic from a legal point of view, and the original idea was to, from the University of Vigo, that is my university, to provide support, a background for this topic, since the point of view of international water law and international environmental law, that is our area of expertise of the people involved in this project. And the original idea was to have a counterpart, a Cambodian counterpart, but unfortunately so far that part has been not yet developed. So what I'm going to do today is to introduce what we have done from our university, from the University of Vigo. And the idea was to identify possible approaches from international environmental law and international water law that can support a legal research on this topic. So the idea is that these approaches can support other researches from a Cambodian law perspective and from also from other disciplines and so forth. As you know, water research always should, at least should have a multidisciplinary perspective, and I think that this legal approach can be like the backbone of some those research. So we identify those possible approaches that are in the slides. The first one is to research about the advantages of joining the two existing global conventions right now on water resources, the UN Water Courses Convention and the UNSC Water Convention. I will expand a little bit on these two conventions further. And here we will see that we also decided to reformulate this topic when we started to look at it. So right now it's something like good practices from these two global conventions. The second approach that we identified is the applicability and implications of international customary law to this topic. The third one, the need for synergies between international water law and international biodiversity law. We will see why. Also, the need to do research on possible synergies between the law of the sea and the law of international water courses, especially when we talk about plastic pollution. Other approaches were the possible applicability applications of the 2030 agenda as a framework for action since a legal point of view, to look further on transboundary impact assessments from an international perspective, and especially looking at the UNSC SPO convention, that it's like international reference. And the last one would be to try to apply to this topic human rights perspective. I think we think that this is also a perspective that is worthy to explore, especially the right to water, right to food, or the more recent developed in the framework of the UN, the right to a safe, clean, healthy, and sustainable environment. As you can see, some of these approaches are in green and others are in red. We have, so far, we have started looking at the green ones. It's a research that is in a, to be honest, in a very preliminary stage. So for the green approaches, basically we have looked for information, for sources. We have looked to the existing scientific background. And the red ones, we have just identified them. But we think that are approaches that are worthy to explore in relation to this topic. If we look a little bit further to the first one, to the possible advantages of from Cambodia of joining the two existing global water conventions, just to make sure that we are all in the same page, especially for those of you that do not have a legal background or you are not familiar with these two conventions, These are two global conventions. That means that any state that wants to can join them. They have been open for everyone. They are different conventions, but they are complementary to each other. Is it true that the UN Watercourses Convention is more focused on equitable sharing between riparian states, and the UNEC Water Convention is maybe more focused on prevention of pollution, of transboundary harm, but the core principles of both conventions are the same and they supplement each other. So the idea was to analyze these two framework conventions. They are framework conventions. That means that they are not intended to replace, for instance, bilateral multilateral agreements like the Mekong Agreement. The idea is to reinforce them, maybe to fill gaps, or maybe in cases where riparian states have not agree on any kind of cooperation agreement and so forth, in that case is to be the applicable law, but they are not meant to replace existing law. So the idea was to compare these two conventions with the existing legal framework in the Mekong, the 1995 Mekong Agreement, and the procedures for notification, prior consultation and agreement, and the PMPCA guidelines. And when we started looking at this topic, we realized that there was already plenty of literature on this topic, especially since 2014, because in 2014, the UN Watercourses Convention finally entered into force. So taking advantage of that moment, a lot of studies were produced in this sense. Although they are mainly comparative studies. What they do is to compare the disposition of these two conventions and the dispositions of the Mekong Agreement and related texts. So that's why we reformulated a little bit this approach to good practices from the two global conventions, because we realized two things. One, that there were already some literature on this topic, but mainly from 2014, 15, 16, after that entry into force of the UN Water Conventions, and we realized that these two conventions may have benefits from Cambodia, even if they are not ratified for Cambodia. And also because, especially in the framework of the UNEC Water Convention, there are more recent developments after 2014, 15, and 16 that are the dates of those studies that are worthy also to explore. So we decided to maintain this topic, but to reformulate it. If we look a bit closer to these two conventions, especially for those of you that maybe are not familiar with them, the first one, the United Nations Watercourses Convention, is a global convention that was elaborated by the International Law Commission. The International Law Commission is a very authoritative body that depends on the General Assembly of the United Nations, and it's the body in charge of compiling law, of codifying law, and of the progressive development of international law. And this topic was not easy. Okay, during the works in the framework of the International Law Commission, there were a lot of discussions. As you know, it's very difficult to establish common rules for watercourses because each watercourse has its social, climatic, hydrogeological features and so forth. So there was not agreement between experts, between representatives from states at the beginning. Also, states sometimes are quite reluctant to negotiate these issues because of sovereignty issues and so forth. So it took almost 30 years, that's a lot, to come up with agreed text, to a text with consensus between states. So this convention was adopted in 1997, but it didn't enter into force until 2014. Again, a lot of years to get it's entered into force. It was not easy to get the minimum required ratifications that were 35. It was not easy. In fact, it was one Mekong riparian state, Vietnam, who triggered the entry into force of this convention. What Vietnam was the state number 35 and the only one in the Mekong River to ratify this convention. And after that, only one more state ratified this convention. So not a very successful convention in terms of ratification. But in fact, it's very, very, very important because it was made in the framework of the International Law Commission. So it reflects customary international law. I don't know if you're familiar with this term, but customary international law means a very special sources of law in international law because they are practices, general practices accepted as law, even if they are not written anywhere. So they are very, very important because they are binding for states. What this convention did was to just to put down in a paper all that all those customary rules. So it's very, very important. So that's the main feature of this convention. So the main advantages that we have identified so far of ratifying this convention is that it contains more detailed guidance on the content of equitable and reasonable utilization. That is a very nice expression, but it's very difficult to come up with in practice with what it is. If you look at the text of this convention, it provides a list of indicative factors to try to guess in practice what equitable and reasonable utilization of a water course is. It also provides more detailed and legally binding, this is very important, requirements on notification and consultation. And this can be especially useful in the case of dams, because it establishes a very clear framework. And also if we take into account that the PMPCA are not legally binding, so this can strengthen that legal framework. And also this convention provides a clear framework for dispute resolution that can be very, very useful also. But even in case of not ratification of this convention by Cambodia, its customary content, it's applicable anyway. So those basic rules, and at the same time so general, equitable and reasonable utilization, prevention of significant harm, extent of data and information, notification of planned measures, applied anyway. So this convention is going to be useful anyway, but the problem with customary law, and not only in this field, is to determine its exact content. Okay, extent of data and information is an obligation, but which data, which information, when, how, and so forth. So this is very close connected with the second point that was in the first slide, because further studies are needed on international customary law. And this requires a lot of study on state practice to determine what the states are considering now exactly customary law in relation with those four basic obligations. So we think that that's why we linked those topics, the good practices from these two conventions and the need for more research on international customary law. And if we look to the other convention, this convention was originally adopted in a regional context in the Pan-European region. It was adopted in 1992, and if the UN Water Convention was more focused on equitable sharing between riparian states, this convention is more focused on prevention of transboundary harm between riparian states. It entered into force in 1996 and has 43 parties, more parties than the UN Water Causes Convention. It also has a protocol on water and health that tries to protect human health and well-being by a better water management. So also very useful inputs from that protocol. This is a more dynamic convention because it's closer to the idea that we usually have about a multilateral environmental convention, because it had institutional structure. We do not only have a text, but we have, let's say, a living convention with bodies. That's something that was not in the UN Water Courses Convention. So here we have a meeting of the parties, the famous COPs, where all the representatives of states parties meet and discuss about new developments in the framework of this convention. And we have plenty of other bodies that change in time. There are several working groups that are being updated, changing, and so forth. Right now we have one on integrated water resources management, another on monitoring and assessment, a very important implementation committee, a legal board, task forces, etc. So we have plenty of bodies here. And these bodies also produced recommendations, guidance, and decisions. So here we have a lot of more materials, a lot of more sources of water law. Even if originally this convention was regional, was intended to be used by mainly European countries, it was considered a succeed because it really fostered water cooperation between riparian countries in those countries. So states decided to open it. So since 2013, any state, even if not part of the pan-European region, can access this convention. And so far, two countries outside of this region, Chad and Sudan, have already joined this convention. And a lot of more have already shown its interest in joining this convention. So more dynamic convention. And the main advantages that we have identified so far of joining this convention from Cambodia is that it provides a very detailed guidance on prevention, control, and reduction of transboundary impacts. It's, I have already said, a more dynamic convention with water bodies. So parties of this convention can really take part in the decision making in the framework of this convention. So it's out of power also. And there are a lot of thematic areas of work. So a state's part of this convention can discuss and produce materials, guidance, user books on plenty of topics that are hot topics in that moment. You have an example of the topics they are working on right now. Especially, the UNEC Water Convention has become a platform for exchanging experiences and good practices. So even in case of not ratification of this global convention but by Cambodia, it is possible to attend the conference of the parties as observer. In fact, some Mekong riparian states like Vietnam, Thailand, or even the Mekong Agreement Secretariat has attended already these meetings. Customary law reflected in the text of this convention is also applicable anyway. So again, we have identified that more research is needed on the identification of that customary law that is going to be binding anyway for any state, even if it's they are not part of this convention, and at least the prevention of transboundary harm and procedural obligations connected with cooperation. We know that they are customary, but we have a lot of doubts about its exact content, so more research is needed here, and again, it implies basically research on state practice. So this is another possible field of research. Above all, this convention is full of plenty of good practices to follow. So it can be very useful for Cambodia, for other Mekong riparian states, even if they are not party of the convention. That was all for the first point. If we look at the second one, in fact, was the third one in the first slide, but we joined the first two when we started doing research. The second point that we have identified, like needed for further research from a legal perspective, is to look for synergies between international water law and international biodiversity law. This has came up in the context of the current freshwater biological biodiversity crisis. As you know, you have there some data about this crisis. Freshwater species have the highest declines in population size, and at least one third of the freshwater species assessed by the UCM Red List of Threatened Species are threatened. So we identified this field like lacking more legal research. that means to link SDG 6 and 15. This approach has already been addressed from other disciplines, especially through the water, food, energy ecosystem nexus, but we still lack a legal approach on this topic. Okay, we know that we need to link biodiversity protection and freshwater management, but we still have no clear legal obligations on this topic. So we need to translate all those approaches on the water, food, energy, ecosystem nexus, and so forth on specific detailed obligations for the states. And that has not been done. So we identify this topic as needed for further research. Especially we think that we need to explore synergies between international water law and the Convention on Biological Diversity. That it's the global test that we have to protect biological diversity from genes, species to ecosystems, and Cambodia is part of this convention. And right now it can be a good momentum, because right now a state's party of this CBD convention, that it's a global convention, it has a universal level of ratification, are designing the post-2020 biodiversity agenda. So this is a good moment to go further on this topic. And in fact, we have identified in the last COP, in the last meeting of the parties of the CBD, several references to this need. So, for instance, you have there an extract from one of the resolutions of the CBD, where they say that the post-2020 targets and their indicators for inland waters must place the protection of ecosystems and their biodiversity as the primary focus to sustain life, conserve species, and consequently provide human water security. So we are more or less, we have an agreement on this, but we don't have a legal translation of this approach. So further research is needed here. And there have been some developments in recent times. For instance, an alliance for freshwater life has been created. That it's a global alliance of experts on this topic, but it has not either, a legal component. So we identify this approach as needed for further research. And the last topic that we started to look a little bit further was the need for synergies between law of the sea and the law of international water courses. We know that plastic pollution right now it's a hot topic, but it's mainly addressed from the international point of view of the law of the sea, of the sea governance. Sometimes I think we forget some data, like those that we have in the slide, that we need to connect SDG 6 and SDG 14, because most of the plastic litter that it's in the ocean comes from land-based sources, and most of that plastic comes just for 10 rivers. So, of course, we need to address the problem of how to eliminate plastic from the sea, but if we really want to solve this problem, we need to address the origin of this pollution. So we need to start by rivers. Unfortunately, one of these 10 rivers that are the origin of most of the plastic that is in the sea is the Mekong. So we think that this approach is also very worthy explore. This look for synergies between law of the sea and law of international water courses. And it's not easy, because even if we look to the ocean governance, we don't have a useful framework to tackle this problem right now, just from the point of view of the law of the sea. The United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, that it's the key text here, is the Constitution of the Oceans, lacks any reference to plastics. It only has very general dispositions on obligation to protect the marine environment and to prevent land-based sources of pollution, but not detailed, very general dispositions, so they are not useful in practice. If we look to other more specific law of the sea texts, like the London Convention on the prevention of marine pollution by dumping of wastes and other materials, and its 1996 London Protocol, they are neither they are either useful for this case, for land-based pollution, because they imply a dumping, an intentional dumping activity from marine activities. And it's not the case, because these plastics come from rivers, from land-based sources. So we don't have an adequate legal framework so far to tackle this problem, or neither with the International Convention for the Prevention of Pollution from Ships, the famous MARPOL Convention, also because it addressed a different case. It addresses waste, plastic waste in the best of cases, but that comes from marine activities, not from from land activities. In recent times, 3 months ago, we saw some developments in the fight against plastic pollution in the sea. I don't know if you are aware that just 3 months ago, the Basel Convention on the Control of Transboundary Movements of Hazardous Wastes under Disposal was amended just to include plastics on its scope. But again, it does not address the case we are talking about. It do not address the plastic that comes from rivers. It just refers to the intentional transport of plastic from one country to another. And this convention basically requires a prior informed consent from the country that is receiving the plastic. But again, this is not the case that we need to address. So right now, plastic pollution in the sea is a hot topic. There's a lot of debates, a lot of claims for an international convention dealing specifically with plastic pollution. And whatever result we are going to have here, we don't know if states are going to be able to agree on international convention on this topic. What it's clear, and we think that needs more research, at least from a legal point of view, are more detailed provisions on land-based sources of plastic pollution that at the end are in the sea. And the need for synergies, of course, with the law of international water courses. They cannot be completely different regulations, the law of the sea and international water courses. They need to come up with some kind of connection if we really want to address properly this topic. So these are the three approaches that we have just started developing, looking at it. There were another three, if you remember, in red, that we have just identified, but we haven't had the time yet to go deeper on them. But in any case, we think that any of these approaches can be useful. Again, what I said at the beginning, to support, to complement research on sustainable use of water resources in Cambodia, a research from another, from economic or other perspective on this topic. I think this provides a good background for those kind of research. So that's all I wanted to tell you today. Thank you so much.